Here with this week's hottest stories in the investment world, this is Zach's Friday Finish Line.
Hello and welcome to the Zach's Friday Finish Line. I'm Ryan McQueenie, a content writer here at Zach's, along with one of our editors, Maddie Johnson.
Hello, today is Friday, March 23rd, and we're here to recap this week's biggest stories from the investment and financial world. Of course, the Federal Reserve on Wednesday announced it would be raising interest rates for the sixth time since late 2015, lifting the benchmark rate to a target of 1.5% to 1.75%. This move is geared towards keeping inflation at bay as the economy continues to accelerate.
And then any concerns about inflation were replaced later in the week by new worries over an impending trade war with China, with President Donald Trump on Thursday directing U.S. trade representatives to level tariffs on about $50 billion worth of Chinese imports following a months-long investigation into intellectual property violations. All these stories kind of compounding on each other on Thursday. It was a brutal day on the markets, with the Dow slipping more than 700 points.
Also, all these macroeconomic concerns created a lot of volatility throughout the stock market this week, although it seems like we can also trace some of this up and down trading to one specific story, which Ryan is going to lead us off with now.
Yeah, so this all kind of started emerging last weekend. So we're a few days late on breaking this per se, but has been something we've been talking about all week, it seems like. And this is, of course, Facebook. Has had really quite the week after these reports detailing a political consulting firm's inappropriate access on up to 50 million Facebook users, the data, personal information of up to 50 million users. The consultancy in question is Cambridge Analytica, a data analysis communications company with ties to conservative billionaire Robert Mercer and former Trump advisor Steve Bannon. Over the weekend, Facebook said that it suspended Cambridge Analytica from its platforms while working to determine the accuracy of reports that the UK-based firm mishandled Facebook user data. What does this all mean? Well, over the weekend, these reports indicated that Cambridge academic Alexander Cogan, apologies, I'm not getting the name right there, but allegedly made an app that prompted users to answer personal questions in order to build a psychological profile. This information was allegedly shared with Cambridge Analytica without Facebook's consent, violating the social media company's terms of use. Now, none of this is really breaking news in that Facebook knew about the violation and supposedly blocked the application in 2015. The social media company also worked to ensure that all parties involved destroyed the inappropriate data, although these new reports are suggesting that not all of it was actually deleted. So kind of taking a step back here, this is making significant headlines because of what or who Cambridge Analytica is. This firm also worked on Facebook ads for President Donald Trump during the 2016 election, so much so that they kind of publicly slash privately boasted with how much they helped win that election. And then, you know, kind of to make matters worse, later in this week, there was a couple unflattering, I would describe them as, video leaks of Cambridge employees allegedly detailing their kind of inappropriate techniques of campaigning throughout the world, using some kind of shady tactics in different elections throughout the world. This is an international company that works, you know, with campaigns everywhere. So they've got their hands in a lot of stuff. And then kind of looking more to the Facebook side of things, the Cambridge Analytica story really underscores Facebook's failure to properly protect its users and their data. We've obviously been talking about this for a really long time now because of all the stuff that came out regarding kind of Russia's propaganda campaign during the 2016 election. And both of these stories are now fitting into a larger picture, I think, for a lot of people that are now questioning not just Facebook and its management team, but also just kind of how our society consumes social media in general, how our society and culture values or doesn't value truth and accuracy. And from an investor's perspective, I think you have to start asking about Facebook increasing spending to deal with these issues, possibly seeing some regulatory pressure. We know the EU is investigating this incident with Cambridge Analytica. The British Parliament wants to speak to Mr. Mark Zuckerberg about these issues. This is something that could easily result in fines or add new kind of legal burdens in the future. So that's something to keep your eyes on. Zuckerberg's kind of reputation definitely taking a big hit this week. Speaking to CNN on Wednesday, he said that he regrets taking Cambridge Analytica on its word, saying, quote, "This was clearly a mistake," end quote.
But here's the thing. So I do agree with what you have said. But at this point, it's 2018. Facebook is this mega company, this mega giant. And I feel like the people, and maybe it's like the cynic in me and that's my involvement with these companies, with these big tech companies, Facebook, Google, Microsoft, Apple, that, you know, we follow them so much now that we're kind of used to, I don't want to say that we're like used to how they operate, but if people don't know how much they know about us in 2018, like, you have to stop being so naive.
Sure.
You know, not that this is an excuse for Facebook's failures. I'm not saying that whatsoever. But the people who are like shocked that Facebook knows literally everything about us now, it's, I mean, people, come on. True. Do you know what I'm saying?
Right. And I think this delete Facebook campaign.
Oh, that's so absurd. It's so absurd.
Yeah. No. I don't really understand it for the points that you're saying, definitely. But, you know, at the same time, if you're going to track user data at all times, like Facebook has, those users are putting a lot of trust in you.
100%.
Especially if they are aware of it.
I agree. I agree with that point. Facebook failed in this regard.
Definitely.
They do. Like, they did.
And then you take a step back and you look at more of just the general idea of it, in that, you know, Facebook failed. We definitely agree on that. However, is it less so a failure and more so just an inevitable consequence of the way that the business is structured? Not just Facebook's business, but really any ad-driven internet business. So, I mean, Twitter or Google or like even a Snapchat.
Any company, we just like, it's just signing away. It's like we do it without thinking.
Yeah.
And that's, like you said, it's not just Facebook.
Yeah. So that's my question is really, is this maybe something that starts to get the ball rolling on a shift in the way our society interacts with these companies? Because
right.
I think what you're pointing out is that the ignorance and the surprise is a sign of that ignorance of like, oh, wow, we didn't know anything about this. This is crazy. And I feel like the more and more stories like this, the less and less the ignorance will be there, because the conversation will saturate into everyday life and everyone will just know all of these things and the ignorance will be gone. And then from there, it seems like a logical next step would be a change somewhere.
Yeah. Well, I think in that same interview on CNN, Mark Zuckerberg was basically like daring lawmakers to like regulate them.
Yeah.
Maybe that's the next step. And maybe big tech companies need a little check in every now and then.
Kick in the rear end. Yeah.
And if that's the case, that's the case.
Yeah.
And if Mark Zuckerberg is literally telling them just be like, hey, regulate us. I mean,
yeah. Well, that's definitely a good point. And that's kind of what I was trying to hint at when we're seeing the EU say, well, we'd like you to come over and speak with us, or the British Parliament
sure.
say, we'd like you to come over and speak with us. that seems like the first sign in the like, and we're also going to talk about maybe a new law here, or a new regulation. And so from an investor's perspective, I think we're touching a lot on very important societal and cultural elements to this story. And there's some political undertones as well. And that's all definitely part of the story and part of the conversation. Simply from an investor's perspective, something like an added legal burden is going to concern people because it's probably going to cost money, mm-hmm. and that's going to have a dent on the bottom line. And also, this type of stuff can kind of hurt the company's reputation. The delete Facebook, it might be a small splash in the pond here and there. But, you know, if people actually start spending less time on Facebook, if deleting your Facebook becomes a trend, that's obviously then a concern from an investor's perspective as well. These concerns compounding on top of each other this week with one of Facebook's worst trading weeks in history, certainly within the last 5 years, stock down about 10% on the week thus far. Not good, you could say.
No.
Has inspired. And then you, as you led the story with, seems like we can trace some of the volatility all this week back to this story, because on Monday morning it was not just Facebook feeling the effects, but also all of these tech companies, with a specific emphasis on these internet-driven or these ad-driven internet companies that are all going to face some of the issues that you're talking about.
For sure.
So, yeah, definitely a rough week for tech, a rough week for really everything. One company that did have a good week, though, this one pleases me, is because it is one of my favorite companies that we're always talking about on the Friday Finish Line. I feel like it's only been like 2 weeks since we covered a different story involving this company, but Chipotle.
Chipotle. And is Chipotle becoming the new Taco Bell?
Slowly morphing into...
But yeah, shares of Chipotle surged this week after the company made another key addition to its management team. So just a few weeks after hiring former Taco Bell chief Brian Nichol as its new CEO, Chipotle is bringing another executive from the Mexican-themed fast food company on board. This actually kind of makes me want Taco Bell right now.
Yeah. We always...
What is your favorite Taco Bell item? Go, name it off the top of your head.
I would say the Cool Ranch Doritos Locos Taco was. I also really like the loaded, like any variety of the loaded nachos, whether it's just the variety meal one or crazy one. And then Crunchwrap Supreme, obviously.
Oh, yeah. I do love the Crunchwrap Supreme. My favorite are the Chalupas.
Oh, yeah, that's great, too. Yeah,
just delicious. Like simple, classic, delicious.
Have you had the fries?
I have not had the fries yet, but the commercials are so good. Yeah, they make me want to go and try them.
They're definitely really good. This guy that you're about to introduce to us also, well, maybe we'll get into this more, but he helped invent the Doritos Locos Taco.
Already a genius. So Chris Brandt, who led marketing efforts at Taco Bell for years, is going to take over Chipotle's chief marketing officer next month. So kind of already on good footing. So Taco Bell has earned a reputation for zany dishes, if you will.
Yes.
Out of the box advertising. Remember the Taco Bell fashion show like a year ago or something?
Yeah,
I think it was like I don't know if they partnered with Forever 21, but it was like, it was weird.
But
it was
fun.
It was
they have fun. Over
it
there
was in
Taco
downtown
Bell.
LA. They were just having a good time.
Yes, that's what they're all about.
And also, so yeah, Taco Bell, zany dishes, out-of-the-box advertising, and low-budget food. But meanwhile, Chipotle prides itself on high quality, locally sourced ingredients, and sustainable operating policies. Same.
Right.
Very similar.
I think the only similarity here is the like fact that they've chosen a region to like get their influence from. The similar, they're both like
Southwest,
yeah, Tex-Mex, Mexican-inspired.
Definitely.
And then from there, everything is different.
But Chipotle's new team seems ready to take inspiration from literally wherever they could find it. In a statement announcing the new hire, Nichol said, quote, "Having worked with Chris in the past, I have seen firsthand his ability to generate sales overnight and build brands over time," end quote. He added that brand's experience would fit in as the company looks to reinvigorate this exceptional brand and build sales, transactions, and profitability, end quote. So honestly, it sounds like a great partnership already. This clearly Chipotle needs help on its on a management level.
Yeah.
Burritos are still popping.
That's true. That's absolutely 100% true.
You know, I guess except for people who still get sick from them. Yeah, can't help that. But
step your immune system up. That's what I have to say.
Step your immune system up. Yeah, but it looks promising.
Yeah, definitely.
I can't see where, I'm where excited these takes them.
These two Taco Bell bros back and reunited. As I said, this is the gang that got us the Doritos.
You can almost taco. Like feel the Chipotle. The Chipotle bulls just like getting ready.
Yeah. Well, that's
for another run.
And I think we talked about this when Nickel was hired as CEO is you're a little bit limited, obviously, because they do the locally sourced stuff, sure. As you said, the non-GMO ingredient stuff, free range this, local this, all that, which is great. And it's part of the Chipotle brand. It's obviously that freshness and whatnot maybe has been a problem in terms of this foodborne illness stuff. But that's the identity, right? And you don't come in and change the identity per se.
No, you can't for a brand. That's but essential.
So you're a little bit grounded in that, like, you can't do a Doritos Locos Taco at Chipotle because where are you going to get the ingredients for that? Locally sourced, non-GMO. However, you know, there's something there from a marketing standpoint in terms of raw talent that
okay,
I'd like to
homemade.
See these guys tap into.
Dorito spice. Dorito flavor. Homemade Dorito flavor you can put on your burrito.
Like a shaker?
Like a shaker.
Okay. That's actually a genius idea. Unfortunately, I feel like Taco Bell probably has the like contract with Doritos locked down at this point, and they're probably buddy-buddy with it.
You're right.
But in terms of like, maybe we can discuss off air how to license that. Just like crushed up Doritos that you can. I mean, I'm already picturing
taco
it
in a bag.
Something I could bring with me.
Who doesn't
anywhere.
Love taco in a bag?
There's actually in
with
Chicago
Fritos or something, not Doritos.
To any listeners that are also living in the greater Chicagoland area, there is a place in like Lincoln Square neighborhood in the north side of Chicago that is called Taco in a Bag that they do. And they do like crazy like walking taco varieties. It's really awesome.
I'm gonna have to check it out.
Highly, highly recommend it. I think this is my
that was
first
my favorite lunch day in middle school was Taco in a Bag.
A walking taco is unlike another. So maybe we could get something fun like that going on at Chipotle.
And they would put they would give you the sour cream in those little crazy 3D triangle packets.
What I would like to know, that's
know
a good point.
That.
Why were they shaped like that?
I don't know.
Anyway.
But it was the perfect amount of sour. It was a little too much sour cream.
I wonder if
in one.
I wonder if Nickel and Brandt would be willing to read an email or a nicely worded letter with some of these suggestions.
You should print the letter on colored paper.
Yeah.
Sent it like Elle Woods.
Okay.
And then send it in.
Okay.
You would be memorable.
Okay, I'll do
and
that.
And Reese Witherspoon would
I don't
be
even
proud.
Need if you're listening to the show, Chipotle's new CEO and chief marketing officer, I don't even need royalties for this. I would just like to have it known publicly that I was the one who came up with these ideas. So anyway, moving on, we have a couple earnings reports this week. Obviously not in a very busy stretch of earnings season at all, but a few non-traditional fiscal calendar companies trickling in this week. First one is going to be red hot, very trendy semiconductor growth pick, Micron Technology, released its latest quarterly financial results after the closing bell on Thursday. Non-GAAP earnings coming in at $2.82 per share. That beat the Zacks consensus estimate, which was calling for $2.76 per share. And that consensus estimate itself was trending significantly higher over the 2 months ahead of the report on Thursday. Heading into the report as well, Micron shares again up nearly 130% over the past year, including a 35% surge within the last 4 weeks. Stock was hovering near a 52-week high before slipping about 3.5% on Thursday. Okay, as I said, earnings beat. Revenues also beat. Revenues of 7.35 beat our consensus estimate of $7.23 billion. That was $7.35 billion if I missed a word there. pretty good year over year comparisons as well. Total revenues up 58%. The GAAP net income was $3.31 billion. That's up nearly more than triple GAAP net income last quarter in the prior year quarter at $894 million. And then Micron ended the quarter with cash and cash equivalents of $8.7 billion. So great financial position there. And one thing I wanted to highlight from the earnings release was that the CEO said, quote, secular technology trends are driving robust demand for memory and storage, and Micron is well positioned to address these growing opportunities, end quote. I just wanted to highlight that quote because kind of with this 130% surge, as I talked about over the past year with Micron, the big question has been, can the company keep this up? And one of the kind of sub questions to that key question is the fact that semiconductors in general, and especially memory, which is a kind of heavily commoditized section of this sector, this industry, they tend to operate on these large cyclical trends. And we've seen incredible strength over the past year or two. And I think a lot of investors are saying, okay, is this cycle going to end? And will we see some pullback with Micron? And the reason I want to highlight that quote is because it seems like the CEO is hearing these things out in the public and is saying it's not cyclical trends, it's secular technology trends that are driving demand for our products right now. So I think an important little one line from the CEO's commentary and one that investors should definitely pay attention to as we look for Micron to continue its incredible momentum over the next year or so, or at least the remainder of 2018. Decent report from Micron. Moving on, we had another earnings announcement from Nike.
Yes, Nike, the swoop sneaker stock. Actually got a new pair of sneakers from Nike for Christmas. Santa brought them to me.
I'm a Nike diehard.
Love them.
Yeah.
Love Adidas too.
Yeah.
I love Adidas for my fashion sneakers.
Sure.
But I love Adidas for my running sneakers. Nice. Partial to both. Anyways, so Nike saw revenues of $9 billion. And this was up 6.6% year over year, and this beat the Zacks consensus. Revenues then in the Nike brand were $8.5 billion, up 4% year over year, and this was driven by sales in the Greater China, EMEA, and APLA regions. Nike brand also saw double-digit growth in sportswear and Nike basketball. Converse revenues were dragged down by North American declines that more than offset any gains seen in international and digital. Gross margin declined 70 basis points. EPS was a little tricky this quarter because they saw a tax impact. So diluted net loss per share of 57 cents saw an impact of $1.25 per share. And this is due to a $2 billion tax expense it took after the new tax law passed, you know, way back when. And the company noted an effective tax rate of 179.5%. So the 57 cents and the $1.25, if you take that into consideration, Q3 EPS came to 68 cents per share. And this ended up beating the 52 cents Zacks consensus estimate. And one other thing to note was that inventories at Nike were at $5.4 billion, up 9% year over year. And the market liked the report. Investors are happy. About an hour-ish after the report was released, the stock is up like 6.5%, and Nike shares are up 21% year to date. So it was a good report, solid report from Nike.
Awesome. Yeah. So good results across the board from the two reports we saw, two major reports we saw this week. That just about does it, though, for us this week. As always, remember that you can shoot us an email at podcast@zacks.com if you felt we missed something, or if you want us to cover a different story, or if you just want to say hi. You can check out all of our other exclusive audio content at zacks.com/podcasts. Remember to subscribe and leave us a rating on Apple Podcasts if you enjoyed the show. Thanks again for joining us, and we will see you next time on the Zacks Friday Finish Line.